I don't know where the time has gone, but it's now been 3 years since Juno arrived at Jupiter. During this time, it has been collecting valuable and insightful data about the largest of our neighbor planets. It has recently completed perihelion 21, or its 21st polar orbit, out of a total of 35 planned orbits, which means we are now well past the halfway point of this mission. But what has it discovered since then? And has it disproved some of the assumptions we had about Jupiter from before it arrived? There was some skepticism about whether Juno would last this long, due to the intense radiation around the planet, but Juno is currently in good health. Its polar orbit takes it very close to the planet, only 4,000 kilometers above its atmosphere, meaning it avoids most, but not all, of Jupiter's plasma torus. Or this region of extremely energized particles, particles which have been trapped in place by Jupiter's powerful magnetic field. This means that even the camera is still operational, which was one of the first instruments expected to go. Juno completely surprised scientists though by also discovering another, small and less powerful radiation belt right above the equator, which hugs the planet tightly. So far, the mechanisms behind this radiation belt are unknown. However, although the radiation exposure hasn't been as bad as scientists expected, due to the nature of Juno's orbit, every passing perihelion takes it more and more into the main radiation belt, meaning Juno certainly can't last forever. And perihelion 35 is currently when mission controllers believe the mission will be forced to end. Whereupon they will crash Juno into Jupiter to avoid any future collisions with Europa. The charged particles in the plasma torus come particularly from the volcanic activity of Jupiter's closest large moon, which blasts particles into orbit around Jupiter. Just to give you an idea of how volcanically active Io is, this was New Horizons' view of Io as it passed by Jupiter on its way to Pluto, with the Tvashtar volcano in a full eruption. Juno has also had a look at Io in the infrared, the hot spots indicating where volcanic activity is occurring. Io ejects 1 ton of particles into orbit around Jupiter per second. As Io travels through the plasma torus and interacts with Jupiter's magnetosphere, this causes a flux tube to exist between the planet and the moon, a flux tube being an electric current that travels along a cylindrical tube of magnetic field lines. It is very powerful. It can develop up to 400,000 volts and 1 million to 5 million amps of current. Juno was able to get very accurate readings of the flux tube during its 12th orbit, as it passed directly through it. No, this didn't fry the spacecraft, as the flux tube has a large diameter and so it isn't concentrated enough to do damage to the craft. Also, Juno was in and out of it in a matter of seconds. Juno is a massive spacecraft, 20 m in diameter. And it really has to be, as it is a solar-powered spacecraft, and it only gets 4% of the sun it would do around Earth. This means even though these panels are huge, it can only generate just above 400 watts. But you'll also notice that this design paired with the fact that Juno rotates makes it look a bit like a fidget spinner. This isn't just to make a pretty spinning spacecraft. Juno was specifically designed to detect various fields and particles around Jupiter, and having a spacecraft with a large, spinning radius helps with that. This is particularly evident with this instrument here, the magnetometer found at the end of one of the solar panels, tasked with mapping out Jupiter's magnetic field. Through Juno's data, we now have a highly detailed map of Jupiter's magnetic field, which is only getting more accurate with every passing orbit. As expected, Juno confirmed that Jupiter has a dipole-like magnetic field, although it is not very aligned with the rotational axis. What was very interesting though is that scientists discovered something called the Great Blue Spot, a region on Jupiter where the magnetic field is very concentrated. Comparing Juno's magnetic field data with previous Jupiter missions, like Pioneer, Voyager, and Galileo has also revealed a first for the solar system. Jupiter's magnetic field structure has been found to change very gradually over time, which is called secular variation. Interestingly, this was most apparent around Jupiter's Great Blue Spot. This variation is thought to be driven by a region right at the base of Jupiter's atmosphere, which we'll get to in a bit. A combination of the powerful magnetic field and the charged particles in the plasma torus means that Jupiter has the brightest aurora in the solar system, with a radiant power of 100 terawatts. Like Earth, aurora appear as bands around the north and south poles, but unlike Earth, these aurorae are mainly visible in the ultraviolet, and are mainly produced from alternating currents, not direct currents. When Juno measured the power generated from the direct currents in Jupiter's magnetosphere, it was nowhere near enough to account for the brightness of the aurora, leading scientists to speculate that the remainder of the power is coming from alternating currents. At this time, it is believed that these alternating currents are produced because of the turbulence in the magnetic field. Especially at the North Pole, The magnetic field lines are much more complex, which interferes with a direct flow of currents. This is evident when comparing the North and South Pole aurorae. At the North, the aurora is much more dispersed, looking more like filaments and flares. Whereas at the South Pole, where the magnetic field lines are smoother, the aurora seems to be more structured and round. These are from the other large moons in the Jovian system, Europa and Ganymede. So, while not as powerful as Io's flux tube, these other moons also have their own flux tubes connecting them to the planet. Previously, it was thought that there was a solid core, then a sharp cut-off line between the core and the next layer, the metallic hydrogen layer. The cloud layer was then only thought to be a few hundred kilometers deep at most. Here, the pressure is so great that the hydrogen doesn't retain its molecular structure with two combined protons and electrons. And instead they separate, meaning positive and negative charges can move about, becoming an electrically conducting substance. It can't be a denser metal like iron in Earth's core, because Jupiter doesn't have the density for that. In fact, based on its density, we know it must be made primarily of hydrogen and smaller amounts of helium, very similar in composition to the Sun. Another factor for the strength of the magnetic field is due to the rapid rotation of Jupiter. One day on Jupiter only lasts about 10 hours. Various forces from this stir the liquid up, which generates the dynamo. It is the rotation of the magnetic field from which we can measure a day on Jupiter, as simply viewing Jupiter's visible bands couldn't give you a definitive result, and this is why. Interestingly though, comparing these bands to what you see at the poles, you'll notice it is a lot bluer here. The cause for this is also unknown. It was known that the great red spot rises high above the cloud deck. But what scientists didn't expect is how deeply it penetrates Jupiter's atmosphere. Also interesting is that the spot is cooler than the surrounding area up until a depth of 80 kilometers, and beyond that it actually gets warmer than the surrounding area, this heat, perhaps driving the storm. It has been theorized that the Great Red Spot is a permanent feature on Jupiter, but we've only had about 400 years to observe it so far, a mere blink in astronomical timescales. Looking over the poles, other possibly permanent features have been observed. Under the ammonia cloud layer is thought to be a water ice cloud layer, although this has not yet been confirmed as this layer hasn't actually been seen yet. Similarly, Jupiter also emits microwaves, which hypothesized water clouds would absorb. So, in theory, Juno should be able to detect where the water is present in Jupiter's atmosphere by searching for where Jupiter's microwaves aren't visible, although this data has either not been released or nothing has been found yet. All that being said, Juno still has a while to go with this mission, and no doubt the data it collects will be examined for years to come. Our understanding of Jupiter is gradually increasing, and with this knowledge comes better understanding of how our solar system formed, and also that of other solar systems with Jupiter-sized worlds. Well, it doesn't have to be. All the best, and see you next time.